that's wrong. Sorry. It's
Come for my people.
We welcome you to this special committal service for Harry Joseph Seaman. I always say that the death of a Christian, it is always bittersweet. We know that the race we run as God's people has an end. And that end, with the end, we cross the finish line and we rejoice at being with the Lord Jesus forever and celebrating forever the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom. And yet at the same time, for those we leave behind, it is a little bitter because we miss the one we love. We say goodbye, we carry memories, but we look forward. We look forward to the day when we join them again in eternity. And so our eyes are lifted up, up to the God of the universe who brought rescue and salvation to those who trust in his son Jesus, and eyes looking up, looking forward to that day when we will be together again, reunited before the throne of God and before the Lamb. Our service today is a celebration of God's grace, a celebration of his love and mercy, and also a time to remember one who was special to those who are here today. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Thanks be to God. In holy baptism, Harry Joseph Seaman, Jr. was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all his sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection." Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Harry and to all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We join together with the recording on the song, "Guide Me, Thou, O Great Jehovah." The 23rd Psalm is a beloved psalm that reminds us that our God is a shepherd who leads us and guides us and surrounds us with love and mercy. We join together in singing it and listening to the words sung. The parts that are in correct and bold is what we would be singing together, but listen first to it as you hear it sung by Chris.
So nothing shall I want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet waters of peace. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death unto life. You raise me and heal my weary soul. You lead me my pathways of righteousness and truth. My spirit shall sing the music of your name. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death unto life. I should wander the valley of death. I fear no evil, for you are at my side. Your rod and your staff, my comfort and my hope. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death unto life. Set me a banquet of love in the face of hatred, crowning me with love beyond my power to hold. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death unto life. Surely your kindness and mercy follow me all of the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of God forever. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death unto life. We
continue with the reading of our lessons. Peter, come right up here.
First passage is from Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Our second reading is from Isaiah 43:1-4. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give men in exchange for you and people in exchange for your life.
As we think of those words from Isaiah 43, when you pass through the waters, we think of our baptism, when God called us his own and made us his own through the gift of the Holy Spirit. This Paschal candle that is light is a reminder of our baptism as we think of our connection to Christ by his own initiative. He offers us that free gift of faith. We join together then in singing the next song. It is "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." The 46th Psalm is a psalm that was the basis for that great hymn, A Mighty Fortress, connected to Martin Luther. And these words remind us that God is our shield, our strength, our guardian, and our guide. You will respond with the words that are in bold print, "The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge," as we speak it. God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. We continue with the reading of 1 Corinthians 15.
This reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35 through 38. But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish! What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body as he has determined, and to each kind of seed he gives its own body. All flesh is not the same. Men have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds another, and fish another. There are also heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies. But the splendor of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendor of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another, and stars differ from star in splendor. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead? The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth, the second man from heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the man from heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, so shall we bear the likeness of the man from heaven. I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed, in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain.
The next song reminds us that God is with us throughout every stage of our life, from step to step, from milestone to milestone. He is there to bring his blessing and guidance. Feel free to sing along. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father. We read first from the Gospel of St. John, the 14th chapter, the promises from God to his people of eternity. Please stand as we honor Jesus in the celebration of the Gospel lesson. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." This is the gospel of our Lord. You may again be seated. The passage I chose to spend some time on today is from the book of Philippians, the second chapter. I read it to you. "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Brothers and sisters gathered together to celebrate our God, his resurrection from the dead, for those who trust in him, and to remember our dear friend Harry. This piece of shaped foam is intended to be put on top of a microphone to help filter out the ambient sounds, particularly air and wind that might come from either one's own breath or from the wind around you. Harry gave me this about 8 or 9 months ago, and it has been incredibly handy to me during these months of COVID. I think it's called a windscreen. As most of you probably know, I've been using an FM transmitter during the season of COVID to bring my services to car radios in the parking lot and to assisted living facilities. This little device, known as a windscreen, really helped because the people who were listening on the radio at one time, as Harry keenly noted, would get very distracted by the sounds that would blast into the microphone from all around it. This would include possibly a little popping from my own mouth as I would share the P or B sounds, but also wind gusts and tent flapping. But with this little filter, all of a sudden, listeners would just hear my voice with more clarity and precision, ultimately enabling them to hear the word of God in the same way. I'd like to use this little device today to help you think of Harry and some of the fantastic qualities that God brought to him as we consider the role of this device. So let me summarize quickly again. Purpose of this is not to stand out and be noticed by itself, despite its significant utilitarian value. No, its purpose is to filter out the noise so that the things you want people to hear, the things you need people to hear, are made clearer and crisper. Harry Seaman wanted to be that for the people that he knew. He wanted them to hear love more clearly. He wanted them to hear compassion more deeply. He wanted them to hear joy as it's supposed to sound. He wanted them to hear peace as it was meant to be. And because he wanted them to hear all these things, and most especially he wanted them to hear the clear message of the Creator and Savior whom he knew and loved, Harry made a plan. Harry decided that his role should be much like this filter. Whatever he could do with his formidable gifts and talents to help filter out all the ambient and distracting noises that the sinful world has to offer, he would do so that God's good sounds would be heard more clearly and precisely. And he would choose, like the filter, to do all in the background, without the accolades, without the glory, quietly, humbly, gently, and patiently. Just part of business as usual, because he felt it wasn't about him. It was about the ones he served. That meant as a husband that Harry would be a servant to his wife. He would help her accomplish the things that she wanted to do, to equip her and put in her hands the things she needed to be the best that she could be. He would be her partner, often an unseen partner, in faith, in music, in teaching, in parenting, in nature, and in love, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, until death parted them. And that he was for 50 years. Harry was Wendy's cheerleader, her partner in crime, her knight in shining armor, her accompanist, her best friend, her brother in Christ. But he was happiest as a husband when Wendy was happy, because it pleased him when she could experience God's joy more crisply and clearly. Take notice, for instance, that out on the table sits Wendy's Valentine card for 2021. Harry wasn't sure of his health status, and he wanted her to hear the love, even if he couldn't speak it aloud, even if he couldn't speak it in person. As a parent, too, Harry was pleased to enhance the lives not only of his own boys, but also of the numerous nieces and nephews who looked to him as a father figure. He enjoyed making them laugh with a bit of wit or wisdom, making them wonder as he shared little tidbits of knowledge and mentored them in various skills and tasks. See the bulletin cover, for instance. I believe that has to do with soldering. And seeing them smile as they came to know the love of God in Christ and began to feel the joy that comes from being a people of hope. And Harry, as the filter, also wanted to help minimize for them the distracting voices of greed and pride and selfishness and anger. And so he shared by example and in his words, ever so quietly, that we are at our best when we are not being lifted high, but when others experience Christ's love through us and are pointed in the right direction. Little ones, in a minute, you little girls, I'd like to ask you to come up and pick up a little something I have for you. But before I give it to you, I'd like you to know why I'm giving it to you. Right now in the stores, you see a lot of red as people prepare for Valentine's Day. There's red cards and red boxes and red balloons and red bags and red wrapping paper and even red socks and ties. Your grandpa, even before he saw you for the very first time, was filled with love for you. He was so excited to just hold your little hand, to see your little smile, and to watch your eyes grow wide as you experienced the beauty of being loved and in loving God and others. So today, as you think of him, I want to give you a little tiny box of candy. May it remind you of a grandpa who wanted you to know the sweetness of God's love in all its beauty and the joy of being both loved by others and loving others. He'd want you to know that God gave you a heart to beat inside you, beating all the time to remind you that he, the Lord of the universe, is there every second of every day to love you and care for you. You don't have to come to me, I'll come to you. I also have a little mailbox for you. Remember the grandpa who was always thinking about you and giving you his messages of love. And then, of course, there were the people like me and some of you, other relatives, co-workers, fellow members of clubs and activities, fellow church members and friends. Harry had that little glint in his eye that played with your words, had a funny jab, shared his mandolin or violin music, or offered a word of encouragement or assistance. With us too, even though we were maybe not a part of his closest circle, he wanted us to be relieved of burdens, to help solve problems, solve our problems, and to just give us a little uplift in ordinary or mundane days, but always in the background as the filter. But look what I've been doing. I've been singing Harry's praises. I've been highlighting some of Harry's grand qualities, which God gave him, and helping you see Harry as the wonderful guy he was. And I'm happy to do that because he was. But remember the filter. Harry didn't like being the star of the show. Harry liked being a servant to help others grow in their understanding of what was most important. He wanted all to hear more crisply, to see more clearly, and to be more radiantly when they were blessed with the most important message of all. And that message is not the story of Harry. Harry'd be awfully disappointed with me today if, as his pastor, all you left and only heard from me was some good words about him. But you see, that's why I have this. Because our text for today shows us the secret behind the Harry that we knew, the heartbeat that enabled Harry to enjoy being out of the spotlight and celebrating the one who should be. His name, of course, is Jesus. And look at him. He was Almighty God, King of kings and Lord of lords. He deserved to be lauded and praised to the highest degree as the creator of all things. Every knee should have bowed and every tongue should have confessed his name when he made his first journey to be among us. But instead, he comes in humility and simplicity. He comes as a servant in selflessness to save those who would not have honored God and would not have known a relationship with their Creator were it not for his intervention. In fact, his reward from us instead was degradation, persecution, crucifixion. The text says it so beautifully. Who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. You see, he had a job to do. And that job was not about being exalted and glorified. The time would come for that. It was about rescue and deliverance from the unholy trinity of sin, death, and the devil. Jesus needed to become the filter that shut out the voices of pride, greed, selfishness, anger, jealousy, and vengeance, so that the clarity and beauty of God's love might be plainly known. But fulfilling that mission would mean utter degradation. It would mean carrying on our sin on his own body on the tree, enduring its punishment and arising from death to life. But that he did, willingly and voluntarily for us. As St. John says, how great is the love the Father has for us, that we should be called children of God. Harry was an ambassador of that incredible Savior. And the self-sacrificing love that Jesus showed for him, he also planted in him so that Harry could help others in their walk in life and in their walk in faith. May God bring peace and strength to all of you in this time of loss. And may he enable you to see through the tears to the wonderful promise that Jesus offers in the gospel lesson we read. In my Father's house are many rooms. I go there to prepare a place for you. I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Harry Joseph Seaman, raised to be with Christ, January 29th, 2021. He's home. He's home with Jesus in the mansion Jesus prepared for him. He is risen, and so will we. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift that Harry was to each one here. And we thank you for the memories and moments of joy that he brought. We thank you for his faith. We thank you for his love. We thank you for his tenderness, his gentleness, his patience. And most of all, we thank you especially for sending Jesus to be his Savior and to open the gates of heaven so that he may enter. As we take the time to remember him a little more now, we pray that you would send your Spirit upon us and bring your peace and comfort to all who are gathered here today. In Jesus' name, amen. This time we have an opportunity for a number of remembrances, if people would like to come forward who have been planning to speak. Why don't you come up here, Andrew, if you're...
So, you know, last few days I've been going through, you know, some of my dad's effects. You know, he collected stuff, too much stuff sometimes we think, but we are going through some of the little things of on his dresser, these little lapel pins right here. And there's one for aircraft, the radioactive material, for an Olympic shooting thing, little things. He had so many different interests and hobbies. And the one thing that he valued most above all those was family and the love that we all had for each other. He just wanted to see us be happy. He didn't care what we were doing. Just be happy. That's all it was. If he had that, then he was good. And you'll be missed. But life goes on, and that's what he wants us to do, to continue just to continue on and do things that would still make him proud. Being selfless, being kind to each other. Don't yell at each other. Keep your voices down. And if we say nothing to excess, including moderation, every now and then, he'll be happy with that too. So, thank you.
Good day, family. Love you all. You know, it's been quite a bit of hard on our family. The ones we love very much that gave us all opportunities to be where we're at now. Harry, since, you know, we have U.S. Army in our family, and we always had U.S. Army in our family. Harry hasn't served U.S. Army, but he has served our lives. And for that, Harry's actually been more of a hero than a U.S. Army hero. He raised Chris and Andy up as to be a strong, good, really strong man. And he raised us nephews up as pretty talented. You know, he gave us some talented that we thought we might never had. So for all that saying, I want to give applause to Uncle Harry to being that hero for us.
I just want to say he was a good person to all of us. He was there when we all needed him. I loved when he laughed, because every time he laughed, it made me happy. But now he's in a better place. But we're going to see him again.
I wasn't blessed to know Harry as much as many people in this room, but I feel no less touched by his life. And I just wanted to say three things that I'm thankful for him. One is his curiosity, which was both intellectual and childlike at the same time. He never stopped asking me questions. I'm a doctor, and so he always would ask me things and always got beyond everything that I could possibly know, and always wanted us to better ourselves and to know more and to live life asking questions. And I thank him for that. I also felt so blessed that he was so thankful in every moment and had just this simple joy and thankfulness, whether we were taking a hike, whether we were spending time with family. It reminded me of what was most important, to spend time with him. And I think what Pastor said is that love, I think, was at the center of everything. He loved to serve, and he reminded us to be a better version of ourselves through him, through Christ. And I'm thankful that he was a part of my life and will be.
So glad I was able to make it here. I want to say that Harry was definitely a rock for our entire family. And that comment especially comes from not really having a relationship with my current father. As people have stated, he was a father for many, even outside his own family. He was a rock. He exemplified this in his marriage for sure, countless times, and especially on their 50th wedding anniversary on the 26th. I have pictures of him still, holding and caressing Wendy as he always did. And I have many memories of that, and that will stick. He was a rock in the way he showed his fatherly heart, generous and caring gestures constantly towards his own family and his entire family, and especially at crucial times. I think the thing that stands out for me the most about Harry was his patience. And I tried to find some scripture to highlight that. And so I chose Ephesians 4:2, which says, "Therefore I," this is words of Paul, "therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, being diligent to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." You know, like we all do, Harry had his moments of frustration, but I felt like, and I witnessed this, he always came back to that base of patience. And when we think of patience, of course, it means putting your thoughts and emotions aside, be able to bear with one another in love, and the love that's being thereby directly demonstrated at the same time. You know, and another thing is that Harry put his wife first and his family first, which allowed him to be that vessel of utter patience to other family beyond his immediate family. So Harry understood godly order, you know, and I also believe that order served to deepen and confirm his own faith in Jesus Christ, who he is definitely with today. I always remember his bushy and wise eyes expressing, as Ephesians said, the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Thank you.
Harry was an amazing man, and anybody who looked at him and was involved with his life knew that about him. A God-made man, strong and kind. He's the example of what a God-fearing man is. And I am very thankful that I got to witness God's love through another person. He was an amazing role model and someone I still look up to today. He's always kind and generous, and I have no words for the things that he's done for all of us and how much we all love him. And I'm very, very, very grateful, and I will be for forever, that God gave him to us for the time that he did. Thank you.
There's not much I can add to what's already been said. Everything that's been said is so true. I'm just blessed to have him as a father. He was always there for us no matter what. Always generous with his time, with his resources, his wisdom. And he appreciated the time that we chose to spend with him. And he made a point of telling us that, thanks for coming over. Thanks for being here. Thanks for all your help. And he helped us a lot. He taught us many things. He made us a part of his world. From taking me up in the airplane with him when he would go to take pictures of buildings, to his photo studio, to Seaman Nuclear, to teaching me how to shoot, to teaching me, sticking with me through the trials of math and algebra and trigonometry. Sometimes patiently, sometimes not always so, but he taught me many things. He was always there for his family, and he still is. And he's a blessing, very much so. Proud to call him my dad.
Jesus sums up all our needs and concerns so beautifully in the Lord's Prayer. Will you stand with me and join me in praying it together? We pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Please be seated. We have an instrumental solo, and then we'll close with On Eagle's Wings. Thank you.
would like to follow us on the phone.